Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Institute. I suppose most of you know us well, but for those of you who are new to the Institute, we have had a lot of developments in the last year. We now are offering something like 5 master's degree programs, 17 certificate programs. We have a new chancellor here, Jim Woolsey, a former director of Central Intelligence, and a lot of other very interesting things going on. Today, we're very, very pleased to have this panel discussion with 3 distinguished scholars who have been the editors and contributors to this book, The Grand Strategy That Won the Cold War, Architecture of Triumph. I have been awaiting this book for quite some time. It is really one of the, and since I'm a contributor myself to the a chapter to this, I feel as though I'm in very good company amongst people who have had a really an authoritative and bird's eye view of what it took to develop and implement the policies that helped bring down the Soviet Empire insofar as the United States contributed to it. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our panel today, our lead editor, Dr. Doug Streusand, who is a professor of international relations at the Marine Corps Command and Staff College, and Doug is also a professor here at the Institute of World Politics. Doug is an authority on the Middle East and South Asia, but on generally on global geopolitics and strategy. He is the author of several books, the most recent one on the Islamic gunpowder empires, and I heartily recommend his work to you. Next, I'd like to, and that's Doug in the middle. On the far end is Professor Frank Marlo, who is an associate professor of strategic studies, also at the Marine Corps Command and Staff College. Frank is the author of Planning Reagan's War and is intimately knowledgeable about the substance of this particular book. I also would like to introduce Dr. Paul Gelpi, professor of military history at the Marine Corps Command and Staff College. And then finally, let me mention, we have a recording here, a pre-recorded video by Professor Norman Bailey of our own faculty, who teaches economics and national security, both here, but has most recently been in Israel at the National Security Studies Center at the University of Haifa. And Norm is very much the inspiration, the original inspiration for this book, because he wrote a little monograph on the strategy that won the Cold War. It was a review of National Security Decision Directive 75 signed by President Reagan in 1983, actually not long after I arrived in the National Security Council. And so with let me just turn it over to our distinguished panel, and thank you very much for coming all the way up here to do this.
Thank you, John. First of all, on behalf of my colleagues and myself, nothing that we say here today represents the views of Marine Corps University or any U.S. government agency. So you know that many, many of you have had to make similar disclaimers in your time. It's a privilege to be here because it is a privilege to be at IWP under any circumstances. But particularly, it's a privilege to introduce this book here because the Institute, I contend, is, for all practical purposes, the bearer of the legacy of President Reagan's National Security Council staff and the Cold War victory. And One way of defining the Institute's mission is to create a cadre of people in the policy and intelligence worlds with the philosophical and historical foundations and the knowledge of statecraft necessary to develop and implement a grand strategy like the one that our book describes. And also because in the early history, early prehistory of this book goes back to a conversation that I had with John Linshowski at one of the Hoover Institution's Washington receptions, at which I told him about another friend of mine, Joseph Shatton's project on the heroes of the Cold War for the Heritage Foundation, which produced a book called The Architects of Victory. And John told me that he hoped the list of heroes of the Cold War included Judge Clark. And while Joe Shatton's list was very selective, it included only Winston Churchill, Harry Truman, Conrad Adenauer, Margaret Thatcher, both John Paul II and Ronald Reagan. I never forgot not only what John said, but the heartfelt way in which he said it. So, as we heard, Norman Bailey's monograph was the inspiration for this book and forms its nucleus. So I'd like to start with the video that he made.
This is Jeff Finger interviewing Dr. Norman Bailey, co-editor and co-author of the recently published book, The Grand Strategy That Won the Cold War, Architecture of Triumph. Dr. Bailey, what is the historical background of this book?
During the period after the election of Ronald Reagan in November of 1980 and his inauguration in January of 1981, in an interview, Governor Reagan was asked, what is going to be your strategy and what is going to be your policies with reference to the Cold War once you are inaugurated as president? Governor Reagan responded, "We win, they lose." This was after decades when American strategy and American policy towards the Soviet Union and the Soviet bloc fluctuated between containment on the one hand and accommodation on the other hand, usually referred to as detente. Governor Reagan completely opposed this kind of fluctuation. He wasn't interested in containment. He wasn't interested in detente. He was interested in winning the Cold War. Through Richard Allen, his first national security advisor, he put together a team of men and women on the staff of the National Security Council at the White House and tasked this team with developing a grand strategy of all the different elements of international policy and strategy, such as diplomacy, public diplomacy, economic strategies, subversion, military display, to achieve the goal of winning the Cold War. By almost exactly 2 years after taking office, President Reagan was presented with the grand strategy in National Security Decision Directive 75 of January 1983. This was approved by the National Security Council and became U.S. policy. In an incredibly short period of time, by 1989, the year President Reagan left office, the Soviet bloc disintegrated, and in December of 1991, the Soviet Union itself fell apart. And this was the background of the development of the Grand Strategy to win the Cold War.
What led up to its preparation?
The book is based upon a monograph that I published in 1998 with the second edition in 1999 due to the fact that following the end of the Cold War, there was a great deal of misinterpretation and a misanalysis of what had happened and who was responsible for what. And the common general theme of analysts and historians and commentators was that the Reagan administration and President Reagan himself had very little to do with the matter, that it was a combination of the general decrepitude of the Soviet Union coupled with the policies of the last General Secretary of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, Mikhail Gorbachev. When the actual documents began to be declassified, I decided to publish a correction to this, publishing the actual documents themselves, which demonstrated the grand strategy which was developed by the Reagan administration and then carried out by it. This resulted in the monograph, strategic plan that ended the Cold War. As I said, it was published in 1998 with the second edition with more documents in 1999. Subsequently, Doug Streusand, the principal editor of the book that was just published last month, was decided that he wanted to develop a book based upon the monograph with chapters by people who were directly involved, members of the National Security Council staff, such as myself and others, based on the monograph, and other chapters written by historians and commentators. And this is the book that was just published, The Grand Strategy That Won the Cold War, Architecture of Triumph.
What do you and the other editors and authors hope to accomplish through the publication of the book?
It's remarkable that in the history of the United States, there have been very few examples of a grand strategy that was developed and carried out. In recent years, since the end of the Cold War and since the beginning of the new war with Islamic extremism, which began with the attacks in September 2001, there has been a total lack of other than tactical responses to immediate threats, which is typical of American history. Our hope is that by demonstrating what the Reagan administration accomplished, we will be able to encourage people, perhaps the next administration, to actually develop a meaningful strategy covering all the elements of national power in order to confront this new and extremely dangerous threat.
Thank you.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you for the video. One of the advantages or disadvantages of speaking after Norman Bailey is that Norman says what needs to be said with clarity, brevity, and force, and thus becomes a hard act to follow. I felt that this book was necessary. I judged that this book was necessary because of the extraordinary, defective, dominant historical narrative of the end of the Cold War, which made a hero out of Mikhail Gorbachev, whose intent was to keep the Communist Party in power, ignores the efforts of the Reagan administration to defeat the Soviet Union. And on another level, there's now a great deal of scholarship on the National Security Council staff and its history. And all of that scholarship, so far as I know, focuses solely on the Iran-Contra affair, and thus makes President Reagan's National Security Council staff one of the worst in history, whereas in fact it was unquestionably the best. And it appears to me, particularly from looking at David Crist's recent book on the long twilight struggle between the United States and Iran, that the one of the reasons for the Iran-Contra scandal is that Iran was, after all, a sideshow. And the Reagan administration naturally viewed Iran within the Cold War framework. But beyond the need to correct this record and also to give the heroes of the Cold War, some of the heroes of the Cold War, their due, and I was always kept thinking about the difference between the heroes of World War II and the treatment of the heroes of the Cold War. No politician who came of age before 1991 is asked on the campaign trail, what did you do in the war? Whereas it was extremely difficult for a politician without a war record of some kind to be elected in this country after the Second World War. But even more importantly, I regard the book as essential because of the need to demonstrate that the United States is capable of developing an integrated, comprehensive grand strategy. It would have been a long-term grand strategy, but it was successful too fast. And when it is commonplace to bemoan the inability of the United States to develop and execute a strategy, it is certainly true that American political culture might in general be characterized as anti-strategic or a-strategic, if you think about Walter Russell Mead's four schools of American foreign policy. Two of them, the Jeffersonians and the Wilsonians, are decidedly anti-strategic. The Jacksonians are a-strategic. Only the Hamiltonians embrace the idea that the United States needs strategy as much as any other great power in history has. That is among the reasons that Dr. Gelpi and I have occasionally toyed with it, designated or dating ourselves as neo-Hamiltonians. But with the impetus from President Reagan that Dr. Marlo is going to describe, and the excellent team that his first two National Security Council advisors assembled, it was possible for the United States to develop a profound and effective grand strategy, even though not all of the executive branch supported it at all, even under Secretary Shultz. The Department of State was opposed, and not even all of the members of the president's inner circle really understood what was going on. Once we conceived the project, in order for it to go forward, in addition to the contributors from the Reagan team, whom Norman Bailey recruited, it was necessary for the credibility of the project to have a genuine expert on Reagan administration involved in it. And fortunately, I needed only to go upstairs in Breckinridge Hall on Quantico to find one. Dr. Marlo contributed two chapters to the book and also provided invaluable service in editing some of the contributions which were either too long or suffered from being written by professional doers rather than professional writers and really came to us in draft form. And that burden was really too great for both of us. And it became necessary for me to call on my close friend and collaborator, Paul Gelpi, who took, I think, more time than he expected away from his work as a historian of the Cold War in order to help to bring this book to completion. I'd also like to mention, in addition to the, you know, the contributors from the team, you can see in the table of contents, the contribution of Derek LeBert, an extraordinarily insightful historian, policy analyst, and author of perhaps the best book of Cold War history, until and unless Gelpi produces one, The 50-Year Wound, and also a very provocative and compelling book on recent American foreign policy called Magic and Mayhem. And with that, I will turn over to Dr. Marlo and then Dr. Gelpi.
Okay, well, thank you, Doug. I think I've paid you sufficiently under the table to say nice things about me, so I appreciate you. I got my money's worth. My goal is really to talk a bit about the role that Reagan played in all of this. That said, I'm a little uncomfortable talking about that for a couple of reasons. First off, I'm in the presence of people who worked for him. They knew him, they interacted with him routinely. They know him better than I can pretend to. And so I'm at a distinct disadvantage talking with a book of contributors, all of whom, many of whom worked for Ronald Reagan. To be the one to talk about Ronald Reagan seems a bit incongruous to me. But I hope that my depiction of Reagan is at least not too far off the mark. The only consolation I can take from that is if you read enough of the biographies of people who worked for Reagan or knew Reagan, you start wondering if there weren't written by completely different people. It's staggering how many different people have different ideas of who Ronald Reagan really was. And so if I'm wrong, at least I can point to somebody who knows him better who is also wrong and who agrees with me. So at least I can fall back on authority if nothing else. The other reason I'm a little uncomfortable is I have to make a bit of a confession here. In 1980, the first vote I ever cast for president was for Jimmy Carter. Now, I hasten to add, I was in fourth grade at the time, and it was the fourth grade presidential election. And so, I'll hasten to add that Reagan won a landslide in the fourth grade. Think of our fourth grade class about as convincingly as he won in the actual election. I think there were about four of us who voted Jimmy Carter. So I feel a bit perhaps all this work I'm doing is in penance for that horrible mistake I made those many years ago. When I interviewed Richard Allen several years ago for my book, I asked him what Reagan considered to be the most important element of this strategy, the one that played out in the book. Tried to get a sense of where was Reagan's focus of effort. What did he think was most important? And Richard Allen said something I thought was very interesting. So I quote, he replied that, quote, Reagan could never be certain any one element would work, but gladly utilized them all, flooding the end zone with excellent receivers. Okay, and I thought that was really, really interesting. And it's certainly true. You look at the quality of the people, as Doug pointed out, the quality of the people who worked in the National Security Council staff at this time, and they truly were some pretty remarkable people. But as anyone knows, anyone who follows football knows, if the quarterback is calling the wrong plays, it doesn't matter how good your receivers are, your team's going to lose. Right? So to you, to a strained analogy, Reagan was the quarterback that was calling the right plays. Reagan was even worse analogy. He was the conductor leading the orchestra. And to the credit of the people who wrote these chapters and who worked for him, they by and large understood. People who worked for him understood that Reagan was calling the tune. Reagan was the one who was driving the strategy. I wish I could say that was true of everybody, unfortunately. The people who understand that are still very much in the minority. If you look at, and as Doug pointed out, if you look at the conventional history of the administration today, that far too many scholars continue to deny Reagan the credit that he really deserves. Now, that said, things are getting a little better. If you compare the history of Reagan administration that was covered, say, in the early 90s to the way it's covered today, you are seeing more people, credible scholars, recognizing that there's more to it than the sort of the two-bit journalism that you get in the early years of the early 90s, right? But you know, early on, the picture is Ronald Reagan is a simpleton, right? He just happened to be living at 1600 Penn when all of these great things happened, right? You read a book like Bob Schaefer's The Acting President, and you just walk away shaking your head. That sort of book is just out of place. It's indefensible. And fortunately, there aren't many of those left, though if you want a more contemporary version of one, example of one, Francis Fitzgerald's Way Out There in the Blue, another hatchet job. Just poor scholarship and just not defensible in terms of what we now know about the administration. But there's been a change gradually over time. He's gotten more credit. Unfortunately, it's still not credit for the right things. He now gets credit for changing. He now gets credit from getting rid of all those crazy hardline ideas about winning and instead becoming a good little detentist and embracing negotiations and joining with Gorbachev to rid the world of nuclear weapons and bring peace to the galaxy kind of thing, right? That's what he's gotten the credit for nowadays, to the extent he gets credit. And unfortunately, even in that picture, Gorbachev is the one who's making all the key moves. Gorbachev is the one who's really teaching Ronald Reagan that communism isn't so bad, and we're really not your enemy, and we can just all get along. That's unfortunately the picture today. Reagan gets credit because Reagan changed. And you look at the travesty of some of the counter-arguments to that, and the best example I can give, and a book I can't recommend highly enough, is The Judge, the book about Judge Clark. One of the most impressive books of this time I can think of, and well worth your effort. But that sort of depiction of Reagan is sort of what we have in current academia. There are an awful lot of flaws in that account, that kind of account. Yes, Gorbachev was trying to fix the domestic problems that he had, and what that accounts don't seem to realize is part of the reason he was having so many problems domestically is because the U.S. and the Reagan administration was trying to make his domestic situation harder. So yes, Gorbachev was attempting to make changes, but they were changes that we wanted him to make. Part of the strategy in NSDP 75 is explicitly about forcing change within the Soviet Union itself and within the empire. That part doesn't get covered. Ronald Reagan, second thing, Reagan never changed. You look at his writings, you look at even many of his speeches. The Ronald Reagan of 1980, who runs for office, is very much the same Ronald Reagan in 1986, 1987, 1988. He leads. Okay? His views don't change. Ronald Reagan had many, many fine qualities. He also, by most accounts, was a pretty hard-headed, might even say stubborn man. He knew what he thought, he understood what he thought, and he wasn't easily changed, he wouldn't easily change his mind. You had to really convince him. He's seen guys like Gorbachev. Remember, this is a career politician. Gorbachev is not the first smooth-talking politician that Ronald Reagan ever ran across in his time, right? Yet somehow, managed so the notion that just because the media swooned over Mikhail Gorbachev meant that Ronald Reagan did, I think, does him a disservice. Ronald Reagan understood what he thought. He'd spent decades and decades of time thinking about the Cold War, thinking about the Soviet Union, thinking about America's place in the world. He's not going to change overnight just because you have a more telegenic premier. And that's just, that notion is just, it's just so incongruous with who Ronald Reagan was as a person. Finally, those accounts are flawed because if you look at the policies themselves, they don't change. NSDP 75 is certainly the as pointed out, it was issued in January 1983. It is the last document that is produced with an explicitly stating this is the U.S. strategy towards the Soviet Union. Okay, the Reagan National Security Council staff produced, Reagan administration produced 325 National Security Decision Directives. 325, that's a staggering number. You know how much work goes into those things. There was not another one that changed the policy, despite all of those 100, 200 plus that came after. None of them changed the official policy of the United States towards the Soviet Union. And in fact, in September 1983, the administration releases NSDD 238. And if you read NSDD 238, it sounds very much like very consistent with what was said 3.5 years earlier during the so-called hardline period. So if someone can explain to me how a hard, quote-unquote, hardline document be issued at a time when the United States had given up its hard, the Reagan administration had given up its hardline approach, and a document that was never going to be released to the public and was never was top secret. If you can explain how that's possible, I'd really like to know your dinner afterwards. Okay. It didn't change. The policy didn't change. And the current academic story of the Reagan administration is just wrong because it doesn't understand that. So as Doug and Norman pointed out, that one of the goals of this book is to sort of identify these flaws and to identify the consistency of the administration over time and the consistency of the thinking behind it. So what role does Ronald Reagan play in all of this? And I would suggest there really are three core things he provides to this strategy. First off, it's an understanding of the nature of his adversary. Understanding of the nature of communism, understanding of the nature of the struggle between the United States and the Soviet Union. If you think back to his career, after he leaves acting, he becomes the president of the Screen Actors Guild. At that time, there is a concerted effort on the part of communist-backed unions to start exerting a lot of pull in Hollywood, start getting more pro-Soviet movies being made. It's the idea of you're seeing communist-backed violence against the studio heads. Ronald Reagan himself starts sleeping with a gun under his pillow at night because he's gotten death threats, his family have gotten death threats. So he looks at that, and he sees, arguably for the first time in his life, the sort of the ugly face behind communism. He sees what that sort of mindset is. Add into that in 1952, Whitaker Chambers produces a book called Witness. And in that, Whitaker Chambers portrays communism as sort of this rival faith. That idea really profoundly upsets Reagan. He finds the notion of this sort of godless but coercive and ugly, violent ideology pretending to be a religion and arrogating itself the powers of a religion. He finds it very disturbing. He finds the whole ideology horribly evil. You can see a link between Chambers. He once writes that communism is, I quote, the focus of the concentrated evil of our time. And you think about that phrase, and you start comparing it to the kind of rhetoric that President Reagan used. Think of the evil empire. Think of any of his early press conference where he says that communism reserves for itself the right to lie, cheat, or commit any crime as long as it advances socialism. You can see that similarity, that mindset, that common thread. And so I think you can see in that a sort of a feeling toward his view toward what communism is really all about. And he makes that point repeatedly throughout his public career, his speech for Barry Goldwater. Makes that point after he fails to get the nomination in 1976, when he starts writing his radio commentaries and other things. He makes all of these very similar points. So the first thing he provides, I think, to the strategy is this understanding of the adversary. Second one, I think he points out and recognizes the importance of taking the strategic offensive. As Norman points out, containment, he wasn't interested in. Détente, he was even less interested in. his view was, if you're fighting a war, you need to be looking to win. And you only win by going on the offensive. And so you can look at his work in the early 1950s supporting a group called Crusade for Freedom, which was advocating a rollback of Soviet control of particularly Eastern Europe. You can look at it again in the speech he gives for Gold War. You can look at it when he challenges Ford for the nomination in 76. He's doing it because Ford is committed to detente. Reagan's view is detente is a net loss. We can't afford 4 years of detente. And if you look at his writings by the late 70s, you start seeing him, start seeing in those writings the kernels of what becomes Reagan's strategy, the administration's strategy. You see him identifying vulnerabilities within the Soviet Union. You see him talking about using instruments of national power to start affecting those vulnerabilities. And think about how unusual that is. How many people at this time in American academic circles, how many Soviet experts were talking about the Soviets being weak? Anton, maybe. He was one of them. He wasn't even an official Soviet expert. So I think this desire to take the offensive, and this recognition that U.S. could actually do something about this was something that really motivates and permeates the strategy that the administration follows. Finally, and I think most of all, his spirit and the mindset really established a tone of the strategy. A couple of things. First off, you see in his speeches and his writings time and again this faith in the power of free people. This idea that free people are inherently more powerful, more capable than those who are under subjugation. And it's the notion that we have vast power resources within the United States that we just haven't mobilized properly. And we can do that if we have the smart people together, putting a strategy together to use it, to do it. This role of innovation, I think, is important. Both societal innovation, you look at the technology elements of the military that we engage in, but you also just look at the ideas that are coming out of the NSC staff at this time. Ideas like economic warfare, ideas like attacks on Soviet political legitimacy, ideas like selling the KGB flawed technology so that they take it back to the Soviet Union, try to make it work, and it fails. This is not the kinds of stuff that a bureaucracy puts out. This is not bureaucratic. This is the result of policy innovation. This is the result of people thinking outside the box, challenging conventional thoughts, and doing them in a way, trying to put together something truly new. That doesn't happen by bureaucracy. That happens because leaders say, I want you to do that. And Reagan, I would argue, set exactly that kind of tone within the administration. And finally, and I think I'll close with this, he gave a sense of optimism. Whereas Whitaker Chambers' book is a deeply pessimistic read. He says at one point he knows he's going, leaving the winning side for the losing side. Reagan had no belief in that whatsoever. He had no doubts that this could be done. I can't think of a better expression of his optimism than to quote, or a better way to end my talk, than to quote Reagan's letter in which he announced that he had Alzheimer's disease. Says, and I quote, I now begin the journey that will lead me into the sunset of my life. I know that for America, there will always be a bright dawn ahead. That is exactly that kind of mindset, that kind of spirit, and I think if you look at the strategy, it's there. So I hope I haven't bored you too much.
Thank you, Frank. Before I begin, I'd like to thank the Institute for holding today's event and also my friends for inviting me to participate. Early on in my career, a mentor advised me that the key to successful speaking engagement was to be brief, be seen, and be gone. I will promise the last two, and I hope that you'll conclude that I was the first. My involvement with this project began with a conversation with Doug about a strategic defense initiative. And I related to him that as a college sophomore in 1988, I had written a paper called The Right Move about SDI. And I had argued that SDI was the right move for the United States to take because we could, courtesy of SDI, make a preemptive nuclear strike, it defeat the Soviet Union, should it come to general thermonuclear war. Probably not unsurprising, I didn't get the yay I hoped for on the paper. I think the professor was also a little put off by the fact that I was sporting a Bush quail pen, but it was 1988, I was barely 19, it was the first presidential election I could vote in, I did vote for President Bush, and I was, to say I was enthusiastic is really an understatement. Thus, serving as an editor on this project brought me full circle back to several formative intellectual issues for myself. In 1972, television audiences in the United Kingdom and the United States had the privilege of viewing for the first time Alistair Cook's 13-part BBC documentary, America, Personal History of the United States. The following year saw the publication of Alistair Cook's America, a superb tribute to the nation from an admirer who'd spent the better part of four decades living, first as a student, living and working as a student, and then as a journalist in the United States, reporting on the United States for audiences back in Great Britain. If you've not read this book, I heartily recommend it. It is a superb tribute to our nation. In it, Cook observed that Americans were, quote, taught a very simple view of their revolution, but that, quote, no revolution was ever so simple. He further opined that patriotism, a bad historian, writes the most beguiling history, since it always offers a flattering explanation of a complicated story and satisfies our insatiable hunger for good guys and bad guys. Scholars all too often spend their careers attempting to persuade audiences that the complicated story is not only far more important intellectually, but also is far more satisfying emotionally. As everyone is aware, politics informs our study and understanding of history. If you pick up any book on the period, whether it's on President Reagan or on Thucydides, you will find that inevitably the scholar's personal politics are reflected in their work. This is especially true of the scholarship of the Cold War. For much of the three decades following his presidency, the prevailing image of Dwight Eisenhower was of a kindly grandfather who was out of his intellectual and political depth as president. This all changed, I should say, didn't change overnight. It started to change in 1982 when a book was published by Fred Greenstein, a political scientist, called Hidden Hand Presidency, Eisenhower's Leader. 20 years later, the prevailing image of Reagan had been, Eisenhower, had been refocused considerably, and Eisenhower was viewed as a model president who had guided the nation through a challenging era in its history. Nowhere was this new image more prevalent than in national security affairs. The publication of Frank Marlo's Planning Reagan's War, Conservative Strategists in America's Cold War Victory, in 2012, may, and I hope has, similarly started a scholarly refocusing similar to that of the Hidden Hand Presidency some 30 years ago. As my colleagues have described, and others, the prevailing image of President Reagan and his administration at the time and in the years since, by and large, has been overly simplistic, one that bore little, if any, I would say no resemblance, to the president and his administration. Another mentor of mine, who is a diplomatic historian, once remarked that any event within the last 20 years is the provenance of journalists rather than historians. That may be an overly simplistic view, but there's a kernel of truth. For the intellectual bread and butter of historians is archival material, and that takes the passage of time for those to become available. The grand strategy that won the Cold War offers scholars and those interested in the development of U.S. national security strategy in the Reagan administration more than just bread and butter. And the personal histories of participants, archival material, and nuanced analyses of Cold War scholars. For that, I am grateful to the gentleman sitting here with me today. My apologies, I'm still fighting a cold that just won't seem to go away. My mouth is getting rather dry. Interestingly, The Making of Soviet Strategy, which was published in the 1986 edition of Make of Modern Strategy, Condoleezza Rice observed that, quote, the relaxation of tensions and search for areas of cooperation with the capitalist world, characteristic of recent Soviet policy, is predicated on the belief that the Soviet Union is strong enough to make Western adventurism a remote possibility. While the Soviet leadership may have had an unwavering faith in the strength of the Soviet state, it was not, unfortunately, it was not a faith shared by President Reagan and his national security team. In Indeed, they appreciated the weakness of the Soviet state and saw an opportunity to win the Cold War that marked a fundamental shift in U.S. strategy. In 1982, eminent Cold War scholar John Lewis Gaddis published Strategies of Containment. Gaddis argued that containment, in its many guises, provided the foundation for U.S. strategy in the Cold War until 1980. He ends with the closing days of Carter's administration. And he presents a nuanced view of containment and the evolution of U.S. strategy that all too often those who cite this work overlook. Containment was an idea that informed succeeding administrations in their formulation of a national security strategy. Containment, for Gaddis, was not a singular grand strategy. Now, he concluded his study, as I said, end of the Carter administration, right as President Reagan was taking office. And for the casual and even informed observer, it may not have recognized the fundamental shift in U.S. strategy that was underway from the president's very first speech onward. To appreciate that shift, it is important to consider containment itself. George Kennan is often considered the father of containment, and in his 1947 Foreign Affairs article, the famous X article, he described containment, but the implementation of containment as a strategy fell to others. In 1950, President Truman endorsed NSC 68, and it outlined a strategy of how to contain the Soviet Union. It also provided analysis of the Soviet state upon which their assumptions, their strategic assumptions, were based. And they looked at strengths and weaknesses of the Soviet state, and they noted that it would be important for the United States to exploit the weaknesses. But what they didn't think it was possible to do was to reverse or roll back Soviet gains. Consequently, they did advocate a policy of containing Soviet aggression and expansionism. And the Truman administration pursued a policy of containment over the remainder of its roughly 2.25 years in office. The Eisenhower administration came in, and it initially flirted with the idea of rollback in its the formulation of the new look. It quickly abandoned that no later than the 1956 Hungarian Revolution. That was unfortunate. But, in stark contrast, President Reagan and his national security advisors, especially President Reagan from the start, believed not only was it possible to roll back Soviet gains, it was also possible to defeat the Soviet Union. And how they did so is a story that the grand strategy that won the Cold War tells. Yet this story is incomplete, as the U.S. military experience in the waning years of the Cold War has yet to be told in a comprehensive fashion. In this regard, the grand strategy offers a recipe, to continue with the rather strange sandwich analogy, for others, and suggests new avenues of research. As I have promised to be brief, I will discuss only one with you today. President Reagan and his national security team benefited from a confluence of events within the U.S. military establishment in the larger defense community. The Army's total force concept of the 1970s offered a means by which we could increase our number of conventional forces without increasing the size of the active force. Yet, to fully realize the potential of total force required modernization of the National Guard, and that came during the Reagan administration. Likewise, the Army's airland battle concept, which initially is developed beginning from about 1978 onwards, but is first published as doctrine in 1982, suggested a means through which U.S. forces and our allies could defeat Soviet and Warsaw Pact forces on the battlefield in Europe. Yet, to realize the possibility of that doctrine, it required funding. This increase in funding and revitalization was not limited to the Army. It was enjoyed by all the services. While the final budget of the Carter administration, rightly cited as being the largest defense budget of the Carter administration, which is faint praise, a one-time increase in defense funding spending would have been irrelevant. It was meaningless. It required the sustained commitment of the Reagan administration to make all of these military concepts a military reality. And that funding and that support enable all the services to modernize and position themselves best to facilitate the implementation of the military aspect of the strategy that won the Cold War. This is the story that remains to be told, and for now, it does remain the subject of another book. Yet this story is only one part of how the United States won the Cold War, and the grand strategy provides the other parts. To begin where I began, I will revisit SDI, and in discussing what that college sophomore did not know at the time, highlighted a contribution of the grand strategy to the scholarship of the Cold War. The modernization and buildup of U.S. conventional forces would have had far less influence if it had occurred in a strategic vacuum. Instead, the increase in U.S. conventional capabilities occurred within the context of two initiatives, the Strategic Defense Initiative, SDI, and the Continuity of Government Initiative. And both of these are discussed in detail in the Grand Strategy. Reagan realized that the continuity of U.S. government could be ensured that it would negate the Soviet strategy of decapitation. The Soviets would be unable to decapitate U.S. leadership. We would be able to continue to wage the war after the initial salvos, and the Soviets would not enjoy success. Thus, a priority was placed on developing an infrastructure to ensure continuity of government in the event of a general thermonuclear war. Nevertheless, the success of this initiative depended on the successful attrition of Soviet nuclear forces. This is where SDI plays a role. Strategic Defense Initiative promised the means by which to attrite those Soviet nuclear forces. That college sophomore understood the latter. He didn't understand the former. Likewise, he did not understand the role played by U.S. conventional forces. So take it as a whole, the revitalization of U.S. conventional forces, the Continuity of Government Initiative, and the Strategic Defense Initiative provided the means through which to defeat the Soviet Union in a general thermonuclear war. Fortunately, that war never materialized. Instead, President Reagan defeated the Soviet Union through other means, and those other means, that adroit application of the other aspects of national power, are so deftly discussed in the grand strategy that won the Cold War. Thank you for your time today. Hopefully, I fulfill my promise to be brief and be gone, and you will conclude that I have been right.
Thank you. I'm going to, the chairman's privilege, first of all, to recognize a couple of people in the audience to whom we, the editors, owe a bit of gratitude. One is Dr. Jack Tierney, the long-term Institute faculty member who reviewed the entire manuscript for us. And the other is the Honorable Tyler McCoy, member of the Board of Trustees of the Institute, and someone who was part of the military buildup serving as acting secretary of the Air Force, and I'm a senior deputy secretary, is that what I'm about? For the entire administration, essentially, which is, as all of you know, extremely unusual. Second, I'd like to make one contemporary connection, and that is that the belief that President Gorbachev represented real change in the Soviet Union is as fallacious as the belief that President Rouhani represents real change in the Islamic Republic of Iran. And also, Dr. Marlo referred to Whitaker Chambers' characterization of communism as an alternate faith. And that is an extremely important aspect of what we need to understand communism. The profound but extraordinarily difficult political philosopher Eric Voegelin made the argument for the totalitarianisms of the 20th century as political religions. Fortunately, his work is now, or his view, his insights are now available in the works of Michael Burley, who is certainly not as profound a thinker as Voegelin, but perhaps offers 50% of Voegelin's insights for 5% of the effort of reading Voegelin. With that, I'll be happy to open the floor to questions. First you, and then you, and I believe it would be better if you stood and identified yourselves, if you don't mind.
My name is Alexei Savchenko, and I have a question, but in order to ask my question briefly to explain, I was born in the Soviet Union, and at the time when this book is talking about, I lived in the Soviet Union, and I wonder if my theory, the way I saw it from the Soviet Union, of SDI, was to play the role of the straw which broke the back of the camel, which means that the Soviets, the Soviet military particularly, were sheepishly following and repeating, aping everything what U.S. military did. They would, if Americans would introduce new kind of plane, which vertical takeover, they would do the same. And when SDI idea was voiced out, my understanding that the Soviet military said we need to have an SDI. And then the Soviet, as much as they were aware of the real situation in the Soviet economy, the Soviet economic leadership said, no, we can't do this. And then that when the, as we call it, the racism in coffin, of the coffin started, because the secretary generals, Brezhnev, Andropov, Chernenko, were too old to be able to focus, to reorganize the economy so that it would work properly to produce Soviet version of SDI. And the reason why Gorbachev was chosen, there was only one reason. He was the youngest one. So he would have enough energy to do these reforms. Gorbachev had no clue about what he was about to do, and I read very carefully. But the thing which I would like to stress one more time is that the Soviets did believe in SDI, did believe that it's going to work, and the among many other factors, the SDI factor, not as a threat, but the as the need to reform the economy, played the role of the straw.
I think I speak for my colleagues, agree with that argument entirely. The way that I would state it is that SDI convinced the Soviet Union that the all-out drive for strategic superiority that began in response to the Cuban Missile Crisis could not succeed, and that they simply could not match the United States. So I agree with your proposition, certainly.
The only thing I would add to that is it's also not purely, for the Soviet case, it's not purely an economic problem either. It's not just that they don't have the economic resources to do that. The types of materials, the types of technology you need to develop a real SDI program are exactly the kind of things they can't do. High-speed information processing technologies, all of the Silicon Valley stuff that we have, that is not playing to Soviet strengths. So not only is it a money problem, it's a capability problem. They don't know, they don't have the ability to create the kind of stuff that would be needed to really do a Soviet SDI.
I'd also add that the Soviet forces, the Soviet general staff, were looking across the border in Europe, and they're seeing what the U.S. Army, U.S. Air Force, and I see what the U.S. Navy are doing, and they understand full well how the U.S. doctrine is changing, and that from the shift from 1976 through, say, 1982 is fundamental. The fact that the U.S. military went from, we'll just be a speed bump when the Soviets come screaming through the folder gap, to, we're not going to be a speed bump, we're going to beat them, and we're going to defeat them before they ever get here. And even when the Soviets would change their doctrine in 1983 to react to the U.S., the U.S. Air Force then changed what they were doing with deep strike. So each time there was something also, and when you have SDI out there as, well, the United States launches a preemptive strike and goes to a conventional as well as nuclear war, we could lose. I think that's an important part from what I've seen for the Soviet calculations from their military. I would defer to those who were in the government at the time.
I would just say that I've been an Army officer in 67, 69, in the Folder Gap, introduced yourself, I'm sorry, Ty McCoy, who was on the Board of Trustees of the Institute of War Politics and served in the Reagan administration, indeed, with our superiority for a brief period in theater, nuclear war forces sort of held the ground in Europe while the main force was in Vietnam fighting an effective war, actually, but it was kind of deserted the Vietnamese at the end. And one of the things I was very interested in hearing about, and I hadn't quite put together in my own mind, was the importance of the continuity in government, the SDI. General Stilwell was running continuity of government in the Pentagon, and the CIA was running a good part of it, Carlucci and the gang, under Turner, even though Turner didn't really know what was going on. Done kind of without his knowledge, because it had to be, because he was very devious and unsupporting of U.S. interests. But the modernization of the strategic offensive forces, of VMX and all that together with SDI, continuity of government, and the like, helped manifest itself in that way. But one of the things I think that may be a part of the early recognition of this need to stop the superiority of the Soviet forces, which they kept trying to do, and they all have a great understanding of this more than I do from history, was in, I was a staffer working in the Senate in 1979 for Senator Jacob, and he came to me one day. I got hired, you know, because I thought I knew something about the Pentagon, haven't been in it for a while, and he said, well, do you know anything about arms control? And I said, well, really, no. I didn't know, I don't know something about bombs and rockets, but not arms control. He said, well, you better learn something in about 3 weeks, because we're going to be taking up the issue of SALT II, and we're going to block SALT II from being ratified, which would categorize and ratify the superiority of Soviet strategic forces under a treaty which would have the force of law, and would really help the Soviets gain superiority without having to spend the money. And I said, well, what's the we? And he said, well, you know, you and me. And I said, well, I think there's really only one of us who's got a vote. And I said, is anybody else on board on this? He said, no. He said, right now, it's just me. And I said, well, let's see. That means that we only need 33 more senators before we have an ability to block the SALT II treaty, which is, of course, the great Carter administration equivalent of a deal with Iran or some other devilish deal. And we worked away at that for some months, and got Lugar on board, and finally got Howard Baker on board, and finally climbed around and schemed around in the Senate among the staff that were very highly wonderful people, many of whom have been here and taught and been students and so forth, and we got 34 votes on a letter, dear colleague letter, basically say, you know, just like somebody that, you know, this is not happening in the United States Senate this time around. That treaty never got ratified, and it was also a point which is so key to some of these things that you don't actually make progress on, but you're just a big speed bump. It was used to highlight the great deficiency in U.S. and USSR strategic forces, and the fact that we were really losing, and that this was the first time that we stopped the advance of the Soviet superiority and strategic forces. At least we stopped it if we didn't gain against it. And then, of course, fortunately, Reagan won in 80, and then, you know, he and his top team with Judge Clark and John Lunchowski at the NSC understood the picture, got going, and got everybody in the administration doing their part. But I think a lot of it, some of it can be traced back to that time in the 70s when you know, only two Republican senators won in 74, which you see somewhat of a repetition now. It was called the Sagebrush Rebellion as opposed to the Tea Party. And these two guys came to town, and they began to work and try to educate their colleagues and hire staff and things of that sort. So it was a very important time that I look back upon now, and I can place it in much better context now based on what you gentlemen said. So thank you.
Thank you. Sir, back.
Yes, Malcolm Arnold, former U.S. Army military intelligence. With comment, Captain Ben Griffin from the Military Academy gave a lecture a couple weeks ago at the New York Military Affairs Symposium talking about Tom Clancy, Ronald Reagan, and transformation of national security apparatus and the symbiotic relationship between the two of them with SDI and stuff like that. Now, Brzezinski a year or two ago says, we lured the Soviets into Afghanistan. And so then a day or two after that, he says, oh, well, I misspoke. That's not really what happened. So I don't know if he's trying to take credit for that, or it was basically he was saying it was an economic warfare. And so what I'm wondering is if the economic warfare of that was going on, was happening much earlier, but that really what Ronald Reagan did is he synthesized it and ratcheted it up. And do you see any indication of that? Sort of like Hoover with his domestic programs and then FDR with the New Deal, ratcheting it up and making it much bigger.
That's your question, answer. I've never seen anything that would suggest the U.S. engaged in economic World War I, lured the Soviets into Afghanistan. I think the Marxist Republic of Afghanistan and its imminent collapse played a key role in bringing the Soviets in. And from what I remember, not personally, but the history of it is that Senate and government support in this country really didn't come about until the Reagan administration.
Yeah, I mean, early on in the invasion, the Carter administration does engage in some, but it's pretty mild assistance and so forth. But the economic dimension, I've never seen. I've never seen anything suggesting that there was economic rationale behind it. Quite frankly, because by the time the Carter administration is out of office, the costs that have been imposed on the Soviet Union for the invasion of Afghanistan are really not all that overwhelming. They haven't lost that many men yet. They haven't put that much blood and treasure into it, so it's not the drain it becomes in 1984.
From my perspective, looking at regionally, I think that the Soviets regarded their intervention in Afghanistan as something exactly comparable to the intervention in Czechoslovakia in 68 or in Hungary in 56 to prevent the fall of a communist regime. But we need to recall that even under President Reagan, though he was willing to engage in economic warfare against the Soviet Union, he was not willing to use the term, to have the term used. Because it's regarded as too provocative. 1, 2, 3, 4.
I wonder if you can just comment on the importance of two factors. First is personnel. I mean, the president's idea was quite radical to actually win the Cold War. And as you mentioned, there were elements of the executive branch that were quite opposed to that throughout a good deal of his presidency. So particularly on the NSC staff, how conscious were people about putting not only at the very top to be people who were actually believers in the strategy, but actually to put it down in the levels of those people who are going to be engaged in those interagency battles and having to oversee execution. The second, if you just comment on your assessment of the importance of covert action in supporting particularly things like political warfare by undermining the Soviet economy to the overall balance of factors that contributed to that.
I think, based on what I know, and again, we have people who can give eyewitness testimony. Unfortunately, Dr. Bailey is not in a position to respond to questions at the moment. I believe that the National Security Council staff team understood the program. Then that they were recruited on the basis of their understanding of the program. Think about Roger Robinson's chapter, that I have the impression that during the era of national security advisors Allen, Clark, and McFarland, that there may well have been greater care in the selection of National Security Council staff members than there was before and has been since. So that's the first. So your second question, if you remind me of that.
Covert action, and it's important.
Yes, please.
I just wanted to comment on this because I was one of the people who was hired.
Yeah.
And I was hired when Richard Pipes, who was the first Soviet affairs advisor, to the president in the NSC when his first 2 years were up. And, you know, if you're a professor at Harvard, you lose your professorship if you stay away for more than 2 years. So they looked around for a successor for Professor Pipes, and there weren't too many people out there who actually supported the president's program and strategy. And I was interviewed for the job, and I supported it, and I had voted for him, and there weren't too many, you know, just weren't that many experts on Soviet affairs you could say that about. And I happened to be pretty young at the time, but they were ready to take, you know, to take me on board because they felt that they could trust me when it came to supporting and helping develop the strategy.
But in theory, and I was part of an administration, I could have just gone and said, who's the best Russia expert at state? Who's the best foreign service officer who knows Russia? They're a civil servant. They've got to implement what the president wants to have done, and let's just hire him. But instead, they clearly had a decision that we need somebody who actually believes in this policy and is going to go fight the battles and defend this policy across the government in these battles.
I had been working at the State Department, but I was by no means the senior Soviet person over there.
But there is Soviet in my field in study of the Islamic world. My friend Daniel Bibes, Richard Bibes' son, made the great observation that we often mistake erudition for intelligence. I think that in the recruiting of the National Security Council staff, they were clearly looking for intelligence and not erudition. Sir, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
I'm Jim Bruton, retired Army. And before I get my question, I just want to mention that you referred to Eric Voglin.
Yes.
There is an Eric Voglin Society in existence. You look up on the web. Among other things, they sponsor 10 to 12 panel presentations at the annual American Political Science Association. It's for those who want to pursue this further. My question is, I assume that part of the grand strategy had to do with the rollback policies in Central America and Africa. That didn't get mentioned. Would you comment on those, please?
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. The role of rollback of Soviet client states, particularly in the Third World, is a very big element of the effort. And so you see, not just rolling back Soviet client states, but preventing the creation of new ones, thinking, for example, in El Salvador. It plays a huge role, and Casey plays, Bill Casey plays an incredibly important role. He is hired in part because he sees his job as Director of Central Intelligence as to wage war in the Soviet Union. That's how he understands his job. And you look at the people he brings in to help him, he is absolutely unafraid to do so, and so it's very important. Obviously, the case of Nicaragua it ties into the contra business, but the dedication there to pushing Ortega and his cronies out is very real, and it's something that Reagan believes in very strongly. Even another one that doesn't get lumped into the rest, but which is worth thinking of, recognizing is Grenada, as another example of that. Grenada is a very, very big deal. When I spoke to Jane Patrick about this, and she said, you know, people outside don't understand just how important that was to the administration. This was a chance to reverse the Brezhnev doctrine, and they did it. And so, it was very important.
Doug, if I just may add, a large part of the logic behind the support of those resistance movements in Central America, Africa, and so on, is that we wanted the peoples of the Soviet Empire, of the inner empire, to see that resistance against communism was actually possible. And because the entire message of Soviet rule and Soviet foreign policy was that nothing can stop the Soviet Union, and that
even the United States cannot stop it in the third world or anywhere. They are riding the crest of the wave of history, and it is an inexorable wave. And so if one or another of these anti-communist movements could succeed, it would all of a sudden give a new inspiration and hope to people inside the inner empire that resistance was indeed possible. And so this was, it was for this reason, for example, that Polish dissidents in the Solidarity Movement were stealing Soviet arms from Soviet munitions depots in Poland and were placing them on ships in the Polish port of Gdynia and were sending them to the Nicaraguan anti-communist resistance. And this was a covert operation done by the Solidarity Movement, and the logic was that there will not be any freedom in Poland unless we can see that freedom is possible in Managua.
Where is it possible to read?
Excuse me?
Where can I read about this story?
Is there nowhere.
Yes.
Okay. Wow. Well, I'm a graduate of the Institute for World Politics, Strategic Intelligence. I also was in the Reagan administration, but I was on the domestic policy side. Notwithstanding that, I was married to someone who was very much up on all these subjects. And I did work for George Shultz at the Treasury Department. I was his speechwriter few years before that. Now, my question is probably going to be a little hot, but you guys know the answers, and I think we all deserve them now. And I'm asking you point blank, please name the names of those who were in opposition to the Reagan policy, which departments, which offices, and who was the leadership.
Well,
I think we owe it to us.
Well, as the book indicates, the first two people that we need to name are Secretary of State Hagen and Secretary of State Shultz. On a much lower level of the Department of Commerce, of course, because we're looking at the interests of American corporations in the short term, also opposed certain aspects of.
If I get to write an enemies list, this is awesome. Let me add a couple names to it. James Baker, Mike Deaver, two people who, you know, James Baker is a very smooth individual, very accomplished when he was Secretary of State, but he, my interpretation of him has always been that while he respected Reagan's political skill and his ability to connect to audiences, I don't think he ever respected the ideas behind Ronald Reagan. And I think he saw his job as being to keep the old man happy and involved in the things he wanted. And so if I had to pick even higher than Hay, I would put Deaver and Baker in the inner circle of enemies.
Our mutual friend of the Institute, Angelo Codavilla, tells the story of when Armin Hammer was invited to the White House. And Angela said to Mike Deaver, it's Armin Hammer in the White House. Anyone is a Soviet agent, he is. And Mike Deaver just sort of shrugged and said, well, he has a lot of money. But I think, frankly, that we have to name George Herbert Walker Bush. Because, according to Norman Bailey's chapter, original monograph, before the Reykjavik summit, I believe, George Herbert Walker Bush attempted to advise Gorbachev on how to deal with Reagan, which is, when you really think about that, it's absolutely incredible.
Sounds like a Ted Kennedy move.
And since you made that remark, I just want to thank Ken for just saying. I thought, Frank, that you at the beginning, that you were saying
that you had voted for Jimmy Carter as president of your fourth grade class.
And I don't think he'd have won that.
And that well, he might not have won it, but he at least would have been competent for the position.
Largely.
So I believe that...
I'm not done. I just wanted to clarify this one thing about Bush. I had heard that it was George Shultz who actually covertly had advised Gorbachev. I never heard that about Herbert Walker.
Well, that
what
my...
What is the source of your information?
My authority, in the book, in one or the other, we divided Norman Bailey's monograph into two pieces. I believe it is in the second, but it is actually in the Grand Strategy of the One and Cold War. But you also have to recall that, you know, under the influence of James Baker and others, when President Bush took office, he attempted to reverse the policy towards the Soviet Union to a sort of a combination of containment and appeasement. And given that that was what he did in 1989, it would not be surprising if he pursued that policy while he was vice president. But beyond, you know, I have no positive knowledge beyond Norman Bailey's statement.
What about within the CIA?
Well, again, I'm not in a position to name names in the agency, but from Angelo Codavilla, of course, at the time was one of the CIA's bitterest critics. He was not a critic of William Casey, but criticized Casey for not bringing in more people who believed in the policy, but. I think that a substantial proportion, if not a majority, of the people within the agency who worked on various aspects of the Soviet problem did not accept the president's approach, so far as I know. So that's too long to list in the remaining time. We do have three more questions that I promised to include. So.
How you doing? My name is Brandon Weigert. I'm a student here at the Institute of National Security and Statecraft. It's my final semester, and you mentioned Derek Liebert's 50-year wound that was required reading in Professor Okavich's class. And I currently, in my area of study, I have found that there is, Professor Owens calls it urge on the part of many of our policymakers for self-deterrence, where we persistently tend to kind of hamstring ourselves when facing adversaries. And in your research, it sounds like you found several instances where Reagan kind of was the singular impetus for undoing a lot of this thought, and we seem to be repeating it again. So I wonder, in your experience, in your research, is there any reason why we do this? Have you been able to kind of pinpoint, or is it just something that is part of the American experience?
I would say it's people's strategic visions,
or worldviews, or in many cases those visions being blank.
Right. I mean, the other thing we have not mentioned, and Frank and I and Doug had long conversations about one of the things that President Reagan did was. He was hands-off in some regards when people were doing what he wanted. And in the case of the service chiefs, they were fully on board with what he was doing. And so they had a lot of freedom of action, I think, and in a way that we don't always see. And I think that was, you know, to his credit that he was able to take their advice on board. He didn't always agree with it, but... He let them, as long as they were doing what he fulfilling the vision, he let them be.
The question of self-deterrence is a long and complex one, but perhaps the most tragic aspect of it is that we deterred ourselves from using the strategic superiority that we had without question in the first 15 years of the Cold War, when the Soviets really did not have the ability to mount a nuclear strike against the United States, and when in fact the Great Britain was afraid that the United States would do something provocative and the Soviets would go after them because they were the only English speakers in range. Sir.
Yes, thank you. My name is Paul Joyle. I'm with NSI. First of all, I want to thank the Institute and the work that John Wilczowski has done to keep the flame alive. This truly is the one location where big thoughts and big strategies and an understanding of all the tools of statecraft can be studied and hopefully incorporated into our government. So thank you. I want to compliment Dr. Marlo for his third point about Reagan's spirit and mindset as being very important. And I would like to bring up how that translated into real life overseas. François Mitterrand understood that Reagan would not trust him because he had communists in the government. And he needed to do something to prove to Reagan that he was part of the program. So he delivered farewell. The Vetrov penetration and asset that the French had gave the United States the entire view of the Soviet intelligence collection on technology. That included all 80 members of the KGB Linus and all the targets that they had, which allowed later on with the implementation of the National Security Doctrine or directive, the ability to target specific officers and put into their food chain particular pieces of equipment, found their way to the Soviet Union and did perform, let's say, as they expected. That was a critical component, and that's because of who Reagan was. And a foreign leader, understanding his nature and taking a step in order to get closer to the president. And the other component that was very important to our success from a military standpoint was the ability of us to penetrate through Tokachev, the Soviet radar institute, that brought us to the conclusion that they didn't have look-down radar capability, which allowed us to then ramp up our cruise missile program, which was a threat beyond belief to the Soviet military. Because a lot of people talk about SDI, but there's not enough talk about the importance of the cruise missile, cruise on home. They didn't have the ability to shoot it down, and they didn't have the ability to detect it on their radar systems. So it was a vital component of it. But both these things combined, the world of intelligence combines, one by a foreign power, one by a new mindset of the agency in Moscow, that we can run agents in downtown Moscow, and we no longer have to fear about that, which was something that didn't happen beforehand. We were afraid. And a whole program was put together. I mean, can you imagine that meetings were occurring in downtown Moscow face-to-face with Tokachev, only a few blocks from the American embassy? So it was a real ballsy thing. But anyways, all of this is, I think, a footnote to the leadership and the vision of Ronald Reagan, who inspired hope and fear in the minds of friends and adversaries. And I was wondering if your book touches upon any of that. And you should have had more books to yourself, but
if there in fact is more market than anticipated, that is a rare lapse on the part of some of the administrative staff.
Well, you have to be spanked after this
meeting. You do not spank an A plus student for getting a 98. And those of us, and we have had the privileges very occasionally of giving A pluses, not many.
But in terms of the issue, does any of this touch upon?
The Vetrov story does not. There are some references to it. Roger Robinson's chapter talks a bit about the farewell dossier and the information that was given there.
And how does he treat it in the book, like that?
Well, I mean, he acknowledged, I mean, it is one component of the economic piece, part of the economic. Roger's written, his chapter is on the economic warfare element. So farewell is referenced in there. It's a very brief reference. It does not, I would agree, it does not get the sort of extensive coverage that it deserves. And it was a remarkable piece of work. And you know, Gus Weiss's piece is obviously sort of the basic account of that. I will say I cover it in my book. But I think it's important because of not just the impact it has on all the things that start failing, but the follow-on problem, of course, is now they're not sure anything they get, whether it's compromised or not, they have to second guess.
Right.
So even if 90% of what they got, and it wasn't 90%, was good, they're not sure. And so it grinds that program to a halt. And it was huge. At a time when they're being pressured the U.S. military is becoming more high-tech, at a time when they need to overcome the bottlenecks within their economy that only Western technology can provide. They can't trust it anymore. And it was huge.
On the continuity of government, did you interview Reed in the program that was done at the NSC on that?
I did not. Frankham was the one.
Frankham is the author. Yeah, Ronald Frankham was involved in that program on the White House staff. He is extremely assiduous about mentioning everyone who was involved in that particular name. I don't actively recall.
Sir? Yes, my name is Andrea Larionov. I'm from the Cape Institute. First of all, I would like just to say that this is absolutely fascinating conversation that we're having here, and I would urge everyone just to write down what is not written yet, because it's one of the most important histories and stories of our days, the last decades for the whole humanity. So just in addition to what you've already written, just to write what is not written yet, I think it's really very important. But my question is maybe not about the memory of some of the respected gentlemen and ladies who are here, but more a little bit academic one. The session is called Strategy to Win the Cold War. Could you please tell me, at least the respected members of the panel, how would you define the victory in the Cold War? What are criteria for the victory? Which particular events you would consider as demonstrations of the victory in the Cold War? Dissolution of both the Pact, dissolution of the Soviet Union, whatever, some kind of destruction of the Iron Curtain, they will refer to Churchill's speech, Putin's speech. What event or events you would consider as a clear, some kind of criteria? Okay, that was a Cold War before, and now there is no Cold War anymore.
Well, speaking for myself, at the time that this was going on, I was one of the last holdouts to believe that this threat had really gone. Because after all, the intent of what Gorbachev was doing was to deceive. And I would have to say that until the Communist Party's loss of control of the government of the Soviet Union and the Soviet surrender of control of the Baltic states and the Ukraine, at that point and only at that point would I say that the war was actually over.
I would put it's at least 1991, because you may recall in summer or fall of 1990, Soviet Army goes back into pushes back into Lithuania to curb the breakaway of the Lithuanian Republic. So I would agree with Doug that it's going to be when the Communist Party of the Soviet Union loses control and the Soviet Union is no more.
If I may, just if that particular criteria, it means in the case of Baltics, it will be withdrawal of Russian troops from Baltic Republic, which is, I'm not mistaken, 94, not 91. If Ukraine, taken as criteria, as we can see right now, although it's not finished yet. Well, it's an academic question, I understand, but that's a very important question. So that is why I would just really would invite everybody to think when the Cold War started and what we consider the beginning of the Cold War, not only in terms of statements and speeches, but the kind of the event, political event or military or whatever, geopolitical event, and what event we would consider at the end of this Cold War.
Well, thank you very much. We are really past the time limit. I will, of course, give Dr. Linshowski the last word, but I would say that the Russia under the Romanovs was a threat to the global order based on the values of the Anglophone Enlightenment. It was, I believe, an understandable but extremely dangerous outburst of optimism that led so many people to believe that the fall of the Soviet Union would mean that Russia would stop being Russia. And as our esteemed colleague on the IWP faculty, Paul Goebel, would observe, we often forgot just how Russian Soviet communism was and how much continuity there was. As I tell students today, the current employees of the FSB have fathers in the KGB, grandfathers in the NKVD and the Cheka, and great-grandfathers in the Okhrana. So we can see the roots of President Putin in the secret police under the Romanovs. And sir, if you will close this out.
Well, your question is a very interesting one. I can only say that for my part and the part of some of my colleagues in the government who actually believed that the Soviet Union could be defeated, our definition of victory was the reduction of political concerns. The people who were pushing détente for over a decade believed that you could reduce tensions by reducing the symptoms of the problem. And we thought that that was completely illusory, and that the only way you reduce tensions is by reducing concerns. And the fundamental concern was the genetic code of the Soviet system, its idiocratic character, and the fact that it, so long as it was a communist order, it would necessarily have unlimited objectives in the world. And even Boris Yeltsin, after the wall fell, when he was president of Russia, declared that Gorbachev's Soviet Union was still a communist power and still a totalitarian power. And so once it ceased being ruled and having its fundamental principle, legitimizing principle of state authority, namely Marxism-Leninism, once that ceased, then Russia would no longer, by definition, have unlimited objectives in the world. Its objectives might still be imperial, but they would be limited, and therefore it was possible to have a new kind of a world order. And that would be the end of the Cold War.
Again, thank you all for your attention. And since Katie Richards has stepped into the room, thank you, Katie, who works works very hard at making things easy for everyone else.
And Kevin, ladies and gentlemen, we thank you so much for coming. We have a class.